welcome to Klaus Nyengaard, Chairman of TechBBQ Steering Committee.
Welcome, everybody. I'm very happy on behalf of TechBBQ to say welcome. It's really good to see you all. And I'm also proud to say that, as is the tradition, TechBBQ this year is even bigger and even better than last year. We have more than 5,500 registered ticket holders, and we have a really broad and deep program with a lot of exciting speakers from, of course, locally, but also from around the world. Very excited about that. To put together something like this, when you are grassroots movements, that takes a lot of work. There's been about a dozen people working for a year on this, and then in the run-up to the day, there's literally hundreds of volunteers backstage, on stage, etc. And I think we should just give all of those good people a really big applause. Thank you. So another tradition is that I just briefly talk about what TechBBQ is, because I think that is actually really important. So TechBBQ, and this is the sixth edition of TechBBQ, and TechBBQ was launched because a few people, we felt that any strong tech hub in Europe should have its own events. It should be an annual event where people could come together and celebrate and be inspired by the success stories, especially the local ones, to learn from the failures, to meet each other, to explore opportunities face to face, and also to give people from outside of our community an opportunity to look what is actually happening. It'll be journalists, politicians, corporates, investors, etc. And I think we're kind of getting there. This is starting to become an event that really matters. Actually, I would say it starts to matter a lot. So this year, we have three ministers visiting us. We also have His Royal Highness, the Crown Prince of Denmark, coming. That's a first. And then we have these hundreds of people on stage. That's really good. I think it is inspiring. I think we are bringing people together. But also, sometimes it feels a little bit like we are becoming maybe too popular these days. We are sort of the entrepreneurs, they're the new heroes of our time. We will cure cancer, we will bring world peace, and we'll make sure that our kids, they play even more computer games. And sometimes I think maybe we should be a little bit careful about not getting caught up in all of this and be a bit humble. We are no better than anyone else. It's great that now politicians, etc., have a focus on what we're doing and understand that we are an important part of the future. TechBBQ is also a good result of that. But we need to be humble. Anyway, you don't want to listen too much on me babbling up here. I'm not the main person today. Instead, I would like to introduce our first guest on stage, and that's a person that is from our own community. Because about half a year or so ago, we got a new minister who actually is an entrepreneur himself that a lot of people they know, a successful guy from our community. And I'm very happy, therefore, to present the Minister of Higher Education, Tommy Ahlers. Give him a big hand, everybody. And also on stage will be Camilla from QIT, who is also from the TechBBQ Steering Committee. And I think, formally, hello, though we already was almost hugging out there. And I think the idea is that we'll sit down here and try to make a fireside chat, something like that. Where do you want to sit? I think it's Tommy sitting over here. Camille, you want to sit here?
Yes.
And then the idea was that we should ask the minister some questions. Because it's the first time we have one of our own, like the Manchurian candidates, we managed to put one of our own into the government. So we knew you would come because you're one of us. So you will join here. And we actually asked Tommy, can you do a keynote? And the reply back was no. Let's sit down and have a conversation instead. Maybe that's because you don't want to write a speech. You're a bit too lazy for that, or you're too busy. I don't know. But I think that's a good format. So let's have a chat, and we have prepared some questions. Camilla, do you want to start?
Yes, we have. So we couldn't really just take it off the. of our inspiration today, because we needed to prepare the questions, I think, 10 days in advance or something like that for your staff.
I don't make the rules
so,
for that.
No, that's fine. We understand. So some stuff has happened in between. You've launched your new program and proposal and stuff. But we'll take the questions more or less like we've prepared, and we'll see what happens. So the first thing that that we were wondering about is... I remember when you first stepped up as minister, you said that you would take the first 100 days and observe, learn, reflect, etc., and then act after that. And so what I'm curious about is, following those 100 days of learning, what are your key observations and what are the most critical actions that, that need to be taken within your area of ministry?
Yeah, before answering that, can I just say it's great to be here. You know, I really feel that me going into politics, the mandate for doing that comes from you guys, from this crowd, because that's where I got my entrepreneurial experience. This is where I got to, I think, have a better understanding of, as you guys, on what the future brings, right? And how do we actually bring in new companies into the Danish economy, into the world economy, right? And I'm taking a lot of references from everything that I'm still learning from you guys and everything I learned from working together with you previously before becoming a minister. One of the things that, you know, when I look and spent the first 100 days really meeting a lot of people, going out, visiting most of the universities, many of the professionshøjskoler, the business academies, university colleges, you know, I learned that we have a strong, great education system in Denmark. We're spending... know, 14, more than 14 billion DKK per year. But what wasn't clear for me, and that's the thing I'm working on, is to make sure that what we're doing, the great system we have today, will that also be great tomorrow? Is it future-proof? And there are two things that where I think it's not future-proof, and that's what I'm working on fixing now, improving. And one thing is flexibility. I believe we're looking into a world where it becomes, you know, the idea that you walk into university, spend 5 years, as is the tradition in Denmark, and then you come out and then you have a 30, 40-year career in front of you doing exactly what you studied. That's gone. And it's been gone for a year, and that will be more and more going more and more to the background, even for a lawyer, right? I'm a lawyer of education, right? Even that's getting challenged. So we need to create much more flexibility, where we have an education system you can walk into and out of again and get closer to lifelong learning. I still believe it has a value to go in and study and go deep in a subject, so be there 2 or 3 years, but not necessarily 5 years. So that's the key thing that I then made a proposal on last Monday, on creating more flexibility. So we can do a number of things. You can stop after the bachelor. For those international guests here, it might you think, aren't you already doing that? No. 85% of people walking into university in Denmark, they go straight from bachelor to master, and then they walk out 5 years after.
That's actually a good point, right? As an entrepreneur, you know, when you build something, you need to break something.
Exactly.
And how do you convince Danish companies that they should go for the bachelor guys instead of the master, those with the master? Because that's kind of the tradition. Mm. Or you need to have the person with the highest education.
Yeah, exactly. Because in Denmark, it's kind of seen as a dropout when you stop after bachelor,
right? How can you break that thinking?
By, you know, I can change the law, and there's only one tiny paragraph, right? We're changing. So the way to break it is actually to not see, even though I walk into politics, not see politics as something, you know, isolated from the real world, but I can sit down with the real world. So we're sitting down with the big companies, big and small companies in Denmark, and ask them, do you have, before I even did this, do you have the appetite on employing bachelor, people with the 3-year bachelor, and then do kind of a graduate program? All the companies we spoke to said yes. So they're willing to take this jump together with us. So I'm trying to put myself in front of changing that culture in Danish companies and in Danish startups as well, to see start employing bachelors and accept that one day, because talent is only something you're borrowing for a while, one day, 2-3 years after, they have to go back and finish their master degree. So that's how we're doing that. But it's a good point, because it's only so little I can change. Because if we just change the law, nothing would happen, right? Because we're not changing the culture. We need to change the culture as well. And the other thing that we need in order to make sure that our education system is future-proof is that we are focusing enough on technology. That's a discussion you guys are having here. It's a discussion 2 weeks ago from Tech Festival, right?
how, you know, we have gone from a situation where technology was kind of corner of society to technology being in everything we're doing. Is that reflected in our education system? No, it's not. We're not spending enough time on making sure that everyone that graduates from a higher education institution in Denmark understands technology. They don't have to code, but we need to make sure that they understand technology so they can see what are the challenges, which becomes more and more important, and what are the opportunities in new technology. Anyone that employs a 25-year-old guy or girl coming out from our higher education should have that expectation a few years from now that they understand technology. And the other part of technology is we're not using technology enough in the way we educate. I spent time in this before investing in a couple of companies in this field, and I can see that, you know, that's hard to, it's a quite a conservative sector. And we need to change that. So the technology and the flexibility, that's the two main things that I want to, that I'm spending time on right now.
Very cool.
So another question, slightly harder. This was more like feel good,
yeah.
Stuff you would like to do and so on. And you know, you have, before you become a politician, and we all have these ideas, oh, why don't they do this, why don't they do that,
yeah.
Right? And you probably had that as well. And then you're suddenly responsible, and there's all these interdependencies in the whole system, right? There's rigidity in the system. There's politicians that have other views that actually are still on the same side as you. So we have this law in Denmark where pretty much all government institutions have to cut like 2% a year. It's called the harvester method, which in some areas is quite tough because it's difficult to get efficiencies out of a service sector, 2% every year. And I think there was something that came out the other day that actually they would stop that 2% harvester method like 3 or 4 years from now. But it's still running now and it's still hitting the high education, which is your area.
Yeah.
How do you feel about that? As a private person.
I don't operate with the...
Okay.
That's only one. You know... The answer is exactly what you hinted to, that we have to prioritize across many sectors. If I can, and this is saving, right? If I can cost cut in this area where we're spending in total, if you look at research and science, in my area in total, it's 50 billion DKK per year, right? Including ISU. And if I can save cost there, it's a big area within the government. If I can save cost there, we can spend more on health, the elderly, on police, on defense, other areas that I think also interest, you know, us as a citizen in this country, right? So you're right, before I would probably shout, you know, we need to spend more on this, and now I need to balance that, not only with, you know, different views inside the government, but also what I can see is, you know, is this possible? But what's most important for me was that we stopped it, because the issue before for the universities, for the university colleges out there, for the business academies, was that we haven't said when will it stop. So what I've been fighting for is that we put a deadline on it. And what I could get through with was put that deadline in 2022.
So
I know for most entrepreneurs, you think like 2022 in politics, that's tomorrow. It's a bit different from when we're launching something. It has to be on Monday, right? 2022 is, but it's still 3 years for our institutions out there. And I know it's tough on them. I know it's tough on them because we demand more from them. I trust they can do it. I trust they can make the right prioritization within this budget. We're still high if you compare to OECD countries on how much we spend on our education and science in Denmark. So it's not like we're saying politically we're now down prioritizing higher education and science. We're still up there, but from the level we were at before, yes, we're cutting 2% per year.
Is there a link between what you talked, I think before you talked about edtech, right? That
yeah.
You. With your background, you understand that there are some edtech opportunities also in higher education.
Yeah.
Is there a link between that and then, you know, productivity, and you can still cut 2% and so on? What do you think edtech can do for longer-term prioritization of funds into higher education?
I think we can do, you know, I think it's hard to cobble, you know, using edtech and then continue savings, because I don't think that's where the link is. The link is that because we keep on demanding more and more from education system. What we talked about before, uncertainty in the labor market, what does the future bring you? We need more technology in there. So I more see edtech that we can make sure that we get more out of our money, not use that as an excuse to start or to continue the savings, right? You know, some of you that have been in the edtech environment, remember the discussion 10 years ago, they were literally around, what should we use our university buildings for 10 years from now, right? Because some people believe that, oh, I can just, you know, be lectured through Skype or through YouTube or whatever, and no one believes that. Those discussions are gone because we understand that it has to be a strong link between people being in the physical world and people being in the virtual digital world, right? So it's more like using digital tools to enhance the learning experience rather than saying we. But having said that, yes, it does, you know, allow us to potentially keep the level investment level that we arrive at in 2022, and then still expect that we get more out of our money.
So we've touched upon it a couple of times, and I think for this particular audience, this is an interesting topic. You've made the transition from being a very key player, it's fair to say, in this community that we're in today, both as an entrepreneur, serial investor, and so forth, even on Dragon's Den on TV. So you are one of the key players, and now you've made this bold transition that I think a lot of us appreciate and admire, and I like, whoa. But what I would like to hear is a bit of your personal views on how has this experience been, what's been the best about not being an entrepreneur anymore, and what's the worst part about being in this new role, and what do you absolutely love about it? Just kind of your personal experience with this would be super interesting to hear a little bit about.
So there's actually quite, and that might come as a surprise for many of you, there are quite some similarities between the world of entrepreneurship and the world of politics, right? You need to have a very strong belief in what you're doing, right? Because most people out there that you meet do not believe in you, right? And that's the same with politics. The way we are frowning up on politicians and politics in most Western democracies means that walking into politics and saying, now I want to become a politician, people think you're crazy. Do you do this because you want the nice car with the driver? That is nice. what is driving you? Why are you doing this? Because we see politicians as someone that, you know, just do this because they didn't have anything else to do. And luckily, I think most of you understand that I did have something else to do, right? But I do this because it does matter, right? And so some of the similarity is how much passion means, how much believing in the ideas, how much resilience, keep on fighting for the ideas, all of that. And I tell you, that's what I see in people in there, in politics, you know, in my own party, in the other parties, inside the ministry. Most of the people working in the ministry, you'd be happy to employ them in your startups. I kid you not, that's not the everyday perception of someone, a civil servant. But, you know, they're smart, they're prepared to work really, really hard for something they believe in, right? Otherwise, they wouldn't do that. Otherwise, they'll be out in a private company where, trust me, the working conditions are better, the salary is better. But they do this because they trust that they can play their role in making Denmark better. So, and then I still need to pitch, right? I don't, you know, my investor is called Christian Jensen. He's the Minister of Finance, right? So I meet, and this is not like once every 18 months, right, as most entrepreneurs do, right? This is, it feels like every week I have to pitch how important higher education, he gets it.
Why don't you talk to other investors? Maybe there are other investors out there.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. No, we do that. We have some funds that support science, quite significantly, right? And in terms of what I'm missing from being an entrepreneur, I still miss that you can, you know, have a discussion of something in the morning and do it in the afternoon. I understand why I cannot do that now as a minister, because I have responsible 270,000 students. There are 43,000 employees in my area, and we have a budget of 50 billion, right? So I cannot just do things the same way anymore, also because this is taxpayers' money and it's rights and obligations, right, given from the government to students, right? So I need to be much more careful on what I'm doing. So it's not just my money or my investors' money and the five guys and the 10 customers we have, right? That's not, it's affecting a lot of people. And that's why I can understand why it takes more time. But sometime I miss, can't we just at least test it, right? At least try it and see if it works. And even that is it hard sometimes. So
you see, any, I miss that. Any way that we could get some kind of agility or whatever, a leaner methodology into the work of the democracy. I think it's a super interesting topic, and it is a shame what you described, that it's viewed upon this very static, old-school way from the outside, and it's not your experience. So, do you think anything can be done, or is it a lost cause?
No, I think, but what we need to change is that we as politicians are prepared to commit errors. That we are prepared to go out there and say with the same, you know, with the same conviction that you pitch to an investor, even though you know it might not happen, but you still have that conviction, otherwise you do not get the money, and 2 years later you have to realize that it did not happen. But because, you know, we're in a private environment with not that much media attention, it's allowed in the startup community that you can fail. But as a politician, if I went out there and said, I think the most important thing is to create more flexibility in our education system, and I'm going to blah, 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 and it's going to be the best thing since sliced bread, right? If I said that as a politician, and then 2 years later had to admit, nah, wasn't the best thing since sliced bread, actually didn't change anything, right? Then I'm called up on as, from my opponents in parliament and from the media as, you know, what? You know, but you said all of that and that's not true.
That's an important point, because if you are a non-politician but interested in politics and how society evolves, there's a few things I think that stand out. And one of them is that there's such a risk aversion in that whole system that actually is not productive, because what happens is there's some freak accident somewhere, someone gets killed. And then all the politicians, they start yelling, oh, let's introduce a lot of laws. And actually, if someone sat down and looked at it rationally, the cost and benefits of that law that should prevent one from dying once every 10 years, you realize it's actually stupid. You should take the risk. It's bad for that person that is being hit by that death, but actually for society, it does not make sense.
Yeah, but you
and that's kind of a systemic issue in politics.
It is,
right?
But it's also, you know, sorry any of you from the media out there, but also the way you treat the political
it's
scene
fake news,
is that...
Right? It's the fake news politician.
I'm not sure it's the fake news, but it's like, you know, I get a mic in my head saying, so what do you want to do about it, right? I can say, you know, it concerns me and, you know, because, you know, we have empathy if something bad happens to a person, right? But if you start saying that as a politician, then the next question is, so what do you want to do about it? And that the answer is a non-answer to say yes.
You try just once to come with that very rational explanation. Just see what happens.
I'll promise once. You that I'll not promise, because as politicians, I will.
Journalists, please note down what
I will
said.
Do my best effort.
Yeah.
Within the political reality in the parliament and within the fiscal budget of next year.
I think you
to do
this,
what's in my power
yes
to.
Minister. Remember that.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. That another. Thank you for the commitment. Another thing, again, as an outsider, that I think is a bit systemic, that is very much related to how we operate here, is that it's as if every time someone is passing legislation, and when you get into the details, no one, before it's being passed as a law in detail, check what are the system implications of this, what are the software implications.
Yeah.
So what happens is someone, they do something, and whoopty, you know, 12 billion kroner is being lost somewhere, or something, you know, there's a lot of decisions by Parliament today that actually have massive software implications, and they don't check that first.
But we start checking that now.
Fantastic.
We just start now going through, because before it had to be checked by the Minister of Justice, right? You know, on, you know, does it fulfill on our international conventions? And then it has to go through, you know, a few, you know, of course, Minister of Finance. But now it has to go through, you know, Sophie Lewis, area Minister of Innovation. That sees innovation within inside the public sector. So she's now responsible, and have a group of people responsible for looking through that on new legislation. Also, is it ready to be, you know, digitalized, right? Does that fit into a digitalized world, that new legislation that we are passing? So that's one thing we're doing. But I think it's true. Also the way, again, a bit back to you, that we want to have the answers, and we want to show power as politicians. So when I do something new, I also want to be able to show the data, right? To have the data that proves that this was a good proposal. So I come with four things that I want to measure. That's what I say on this level, right? Until that hits an institution out there in calling, that might mean 96 questions they have to fill out. And I want real-time data, right? That's every quarter. So that's 96 questions, because I wanted to show power up on this level. And we need to think through that as well, and need to be able to trust that. We need a bit more trust in the system, I believe. I think that's one of the most important things that we have in the Danish society, is the level of trust. The trust we have between each other, the trust we have to companies, also the big ones, and then the trust to authorities. And we need to putting that in play in the political system as well, so we trust that if I change this, then I would look at the output 5 years from now, and then, you know, and then judge whether it was the right thing, and not try to believe that, you know, I can prove it with some vanity numbers, you know, 3 months from now, 12 months from now. So, yes.
So I think we are. We have a couple of minutes left, as far as I can see. And so you've been, I think, minister for about half a year or so. You had
147 days.
Okay. Wow. That's very precise. And you kind of had your first major initiative and a couple of other things that you have announced. And I guess sort of when you've been half a year in, you kind of start to have a really good understanding. You start to build your own personal vision around where this is going. And you start to think about what are the next major things, next major initiatives. Can you now announce here on stage to the world what will be coming?
No.
Okay. Just a little.
No. One thing that the next big thing for me to look into and you know, spend time on is how are we transferring our knowledge that we produce in our universities, and then let that turn into successful startups. Because I think one of the challenges we have in the Danish startup scene is, and at least the path that I've been an exponent for, is that it might be a bit simple. It's built on known technologies, right? And then we do a new business model. But I would love to see, because we're number three in the world in terms of how much we're spending of public funding on science. And we're doing great on science. We need to do a bit more on technology, but on science, we're doing great. We need to use more of that science as a foundation for some of the future startups, right? Because that's also how we build the next Novo or the next Weedix, you know. And that coupling we're not good enough at, going from a science project or being a student at a Danish university and then come in to launch a startup. So that's a big thing to look at. Also on European level, we suck at that, you know. European countries not good at that compared to the Asian countries and to the US. So we need to do a lot more there.
That's great. Like to hear that. That's great. So everybody, thank you to Tommy Ahlers.
Thanks.